So I've been doing video editing for years now, and even though I kinda suck ass, I'm still better than most people. And I've talked to a lot of dudes who expressed an interest in learning how to edit in Adobe Premiere Pro, but thought the entire thing was too daunting. So I'm gonna cover pretty much everything related to a normal video workflow, and touch briefly on some other relevant programs that you'd be brain dead not to use in conjunction with Premiere. If you wanna learn how to make those cool 3D intros with the dubstep music, then look elsewhere, because I'm just covering the very basics with some helpful tips for anyone looking to start. Also, I'm not a professional or anything, and most of this is self-taught, so if you have any feedback or want to point out my bad habits, feel free to leave a comment because I'm always looking to improve. This is just how I've always done it. Also, I'll be doing this tutorial on Windows because while Mac is very seamless and efficient for doing creative work, I'm poor as fuck, and statistically speaking, you probably are too. But this will be the best goddamn introduction video that will teach you pretty much everything you need to know. And if anyone says otherwise, please punch them in their stupid fucking mouth. Okay, let's get started. First, I'll go over all the stuff you need to do before you want to edit videos in Premiere. If you're looking to record console game footage, whether it's PlayStation or Super Nintendo or whatever, I recommend the Elgato series of capture cards. There's also AverMedia and other options, but I've been using Elgato consistently throughout the years, and I think that while they aren't necessarily perfect, they're the most reliable cards on the market. You can get an external capture card if you're capturing footage on a laptop or a Mac, but if you're smart and trying to go for high quality, get what's known as a PCIe card, in this case the Elgato HD 60 Pro. It's an internal capture card that plugs into the PCI Express slot, aka the place where graphics cards and Wi-Fi cards go on a motherboard. I used to use external capture cards because I didn't feel comfortable tinkering with my then pre-built desktop computer, but after comparing video footage from both internal and external cards, I found the external cards had way shittier audio quality. Not to mention they died way faster. PCIe cards just plug in, so even if you're scared of fucking up your computer, it's a brainlessly easy installation. I also use Elgato because they have a cool feature called flashback recording, which allows you to rewind the footage and capture something at a specific point if you just want to snag a quick 30-second clip of something. Modern consoles capture with no issue, you just plug them in and hit record, but some older consoles are kind of difficult to get working with modern HDMI-only capture cards, so if you want to play on the original SNES or NES hardware, you should look into the FrameMeister, which is the best upscaler on the market. It's like $500, so if you're not dedicated to getting the best quality possible, you can just emulate the games and capture your screen. But seeing as emulation occasionally has frame rate hitches and looks a little too clean and higher resolution than the originals, it isn't always preferable for everyone. But you basically just plug your console into the FrameMeister and then connect your FrameMeister to your capture card with an HDMI cable. I invested in the Ultra HDMI, which is a modded N64 that outputs in 1080p with a mini HDMI cable. And if you want to get NES, SNES, Genesis, and eventually Game Boy footage in 1080p 60fps, then I cannot recommend Analog's products enough. I have their SNES and Genesis consoles and they work like a dream. Since it's not emulation, but an FPGA chip, reverse engineered to function like the original consoles with hardware and sound chip improvements. They're not cheap, but they're worth it. And I'm excited to see their Game Boy console when it releases in 2021. The only real quality settings for Elgato are in the settings, and it's a vague bitrate slider. I set mine at like 75%, otherwise that's it. If you want to record PC footage, I recommend Bandicam first and foremost. Other stuff like Shadowplay or whatever can work too, but I never ever have issues with Bandicam, and seeing as my job depends on it, I place a lot of trust in Bandicam to not screw me over, and I've had too many friends complain about Shadowplay corrupting their footage, so I don't want to risk it. I had people recommend I use Shadowplay in order to capture VR footage since it supposedly uses less processing power and offloads the workload onto the graphics card, but I found that capturing it via OBS worked just fine. Using Bandicam, you can capture an entire screen like I did to gather this footage, or you can choose Game and Bandicam will hook onto the game you're running. Then you click the record button, or you can set a hotkey and press whatever hotkey you set and it'll start recording. To briefly go over my settings, I always record in MP4 footage. I always record in 1920 by 1080, shortened to 1080p. Also, if you ever see 1080i or 720i, for the love of God, do not record anything that ends in i. If you want to know more about it, you can Google it, but the i stands for interlaced, which is a nightmare with video capture or video editing, as it introduces a bunch of crappy visual artifacts when you watch it back. Always record in 1080p. This has more to do with capturing footage from video game consoles rather than screen recordings, since to my knowledge, you can't actually capture interlaced footage on PC. But I figured I'd mention it to help people avoid the hassle. You can technically repair interlaced footage with tools that do something called deinterlacing, but it ends up making footage look like all those shitty emulated retro games with a filter that blurs everything. So yeah, just avoid 1080i at all costs. I always record in 60fps. I don't think there's a reason to go higher for the sake of recording YouTube videos, as 60fps is the max frame rate you can upload, but you do you, you frame-chasing tryhard. Video codecs are a subject for a whole other video, but after a lot of research on what is the best video codec as well as some input from my friend Average Alex, I concluded that H.264 NVIDIA NVENC, whatever the fuck that stands for, is the best balance of speed, total file size, and quality. You can use whichever you want, but again, these are just my preferred settings. In regards to audio settings, anything below 44,100Hz is lower quality, but I choose 48,000Hz since it's DVD audio quality. I basically always set everything, including this audio narration you're hearing, to 48,000Hz. There's no reason to set it any lower than that, to my knowledge. You can also choose to have Bandicam record for a maximum time, which in my case is an hour, and then you can tell it to start a new recording automatically once it's done. I recommend against recording 2 or 3 hour long videos, because not only is it all going to be completely fucked if your power goes out, or if a video ends up getting corrupted, but it's also nice just to have smaller video files so you can flip through them quickly to find a clip, instead of trying to slowly scrub through a giant file and you end up accidentally moving the playhead forward by like 30 years. I set my files to be a reasonably high bitrate, with bitrate being a cool sounding word for like visual detail and also file size. But if you set it at the absolute max, aka lossless, you'll take up ridiculous amounts of space for no additional benefit. I think lossless means like 100,000 kilobits per second and upward, which is just complete overkill. I looked up bitrate comparisons and decided to set mine to 50,000 with a profile of high 444, and then run it through Handbrake to reduce the file size, with no noticeable loss in visual quality. Speaking of Handbrake, I will talk about that now. Handbrake is a free program, and it'll be your best friend when it comes to anything video related. If you want to permanently burn in subtitles to anime, you can do that. If you want to deinterlace or sharpen footage, you can do that too. It does a bunch of neat stuff, but the main thing you'll use it for is to take really big video files and cut them down to about half of their original size, without losing any discernible visual quality or clarity. And if you only have like 500 gigs of hard drive space or less, you will be using it constantly. You just drag your folder of video files into this window here. It'll ingest all of them, and once it's done, you can go through and tweak their resolution dimensions and whether you want to deinterlace or decomb or any of this other technical stuff. And then you can click Alt-A to add all of them to the transcoding queue, which means it'll put them all in the to-do pile for Handbrake to transcode, at which point you'll start the encode and wait for it to finish. You can choose to have the computer shut down when it's done, or close out of the program, or just do nothing. Like, you can shut down your computer if you leave it running overnight. It's just nice to have those options. I also recommend investing in an external hard drive so you can offload big files on it for people who record Let's Plays in bulk, or want to record streams and upload highlights to their YouTube channel. But for that, Western Digital is really reliable and my personal go-to. Seagate has a bad reputation for being cheap and often has massive reports of disk failures. Solid-state drives are too expensive for bulk storage, but if you run your operating system and Adobe software off of an SSD, it will significantly increase the run speed. But external mechanical hard drives are super cheap, and you can get like 8 terabytes for about $150. I use a 2 terabyte solid-state drive for games and important programs, and offload other, more important things onto my external hard disk drives. But over the years, I've accumulated about 20 terabytes, so I can digitally hoard pretty much anything and everything. And lastly, if you're looking to do in-depth video essays or game reviews or whatever, your go-to writing choice will likely be Google Docs. I don't have anything against Microsoft Office or OpenOffice or anything like that, but being able to share scripts with people for quick feedback is always nice, and Google Docs makes that pretty seamless. I guess Word has more robust formatting options, but it costs money, so we will not be doing that. I also don't always have the ability to jot down notes in the middle of a game, so I like using Google Keep, which are like digital post-it notes that sync between devices for free. Speaking of free, the best things in life aren't. And if you skip this ad, then you enter a binding agreement that you're a communist. How's that for a fucking segue? Ridge Wallet is a premium replacement for your old pleather wallet that's probably falling apart and exploding at full capacity like mine. It's a sleek, compact, aluminum card holder that can fit up to 12 cards as well as some cash. Has over 30 ball-busting colors, such as carbon fiber and burnt titanium, or my favorite, forged carbon. It blocks out RFID for tech-savvy scammers. They have over 30,000 five-star reviews, and it comes with a rootin' tootin' lifetime warranty that will survive on the planet longer than your limited time in the this mortal coil. If you don't like it, you can get a full refund within 45 days of purchase. But I'm pretty confident you'll love it. To the point where if you don't, then I promise I'll throw my firstborn into an active volcano. You think I care? I am immortal. They also have other products like t-shirts, phone wallet combinations, switchblades, bags, rechargeable power banks, pens, keychains, and even bandanas. This dog is more handsome than you, and it's disgusting. If you want to become statistically more attractive to every woman or man of your choice, then go to ridge.com/chaseface and use code chaseface to get 10% off of your order. That's ridge.com/chaseface. And if you don't, then I'll be really upset for a while. So with that out of the way, let's finally talk about Premiere. So a lot of the confusion about Premiere is the interface, which is incredibly easy and not difficult to understand once you get the hang of it. But for some people, learning the basics is really tedious. If you want to have an easier time understanding it, then download the free trial of Premiere Pro and grab a video clip, even if it's like porn or something, and try to follow along and it'll make more sense. I'll be going at a moderate pace to keep things interesting, so if you get confused, feel free to rewind and watch again, because if I go through all of these at a Sesame Street speed, then everyone will get bored. So drink your coffee, drink your energy drink, do whatever you do to get focused, and let's fucking learn.
Hell yeah, dude!
When you open Premiere Pro, you'll be shown a screen asking if you want to open previous projects, should you have any. But we're starting a new project, so just go to File and select New Project. A window will pop up asking what the project name and location will be, so choose whatever you want. You can ignore these scratch disks and ingest settings, as those are for more efficient corporate users or some bougie shit like that. I think a scratch disk is like offsetting a bunch of temporary cache data onto another hard drive to speed up loading times, but we're not going to be doing that. All of these default settings should be fine. If you want to know what they do, video display format is asking how you want your footage's time unit things to be displayed, so time code is fine. You'd use 16mm, 35mm, or frames if you were working with film, I guess. But we're gamers, and we don't need anything fancy like that. Under audio, the audio samples option is best. Under capture, this only matters if you're transferring footage from a DV tape, which 99% of you will not be doing. So with that all done, and having changed basically nothing, we can create the project and get started. Now, you might be feeling overwhelmed with these empty black rectangles, but don't worry, I'll break them all down for you before you have the time to, say, hyperventilate. If your screen doesn't look like mine, because sometimes the settings are different, you can go up to Window, and under Workplaces, you should find an option called editing, or you can just click the editing workspace tab at the top to get on the same page. Because I like to tweak my layout a bit, and mine might look a little different from the default. The first time I booted it up, my editing tab didn't include the single most important thing, which is the project window. So I fixed that by going up to Window again, and under Projects, I chose the main project file, and then it pops into the lower left corner. If you accidentally close out of any of these window panel things, every possible box will be toggleable in the window section, or you can just reload the workspace. You can also make changes to your default workspace and save a custom one if you're really picky like me. Also, if you ever get confused where you should be focusing on in this video, every time I click on any of these black squares, it'll get a little blue outline in case I lose you. First things first, the project window here is where all of your shit will go. All stuff goes here. It's like the main folder where video files and pictures and stuff will be found. If you want to add music, photos, etc. into your project, you'll drag and drop them here, and they'll always be here when you need to find them. For now, I'll open up a project for a video I'm currently working on just so I can kill two birds with one stone. But I'll still be teaching you how stuff works as I go through it. I'll explain all these rectangles soon, so don't get anxious, they'll all become relevant soon. This big wide rectangle that says timeline is where all of the actual work will be done. In order to edit the video, you need to have something called a sequence, which you can create by pressing Alt-N, and you'll have all these presets you can mess with. If you don't care, you can just drag a video file into the timeline, and it'll make a sequence all by itself using all of the dimensions of the video, like frame rate, resolution, etc. But if you just want something basic, you can just go to DVC Pro HD and choose the option under the 1080p menu. I'll just be dragging the footage onto the timeline to make a sequence using the video's existing settings, since it's the most simple option, and doing that will tell Premiere, hey, I'd like for this video to be a 1080p resolution, 60 frames per second video, or whatever. Which you won't necessarily get if you choose one of the presets. Basically, just drag the video into the timeline and you'll be fine. Also, if you ever drag a video into the sequence and it asks you if you want to like change it to match like the video's resolution and presets and properties and stuff, just say yes. Just always say yes. Doing so will create a new item down here in the project folder called a sequence, which is literally the project file within the project file. The sequence is just where you edit stuff. It makes more sense the more you do it. It makes the workspace area where you can edit and scroll through videos and stuff. If your Premiere project is a house, the sequence is a room in the house. You can have multiple sequences if you want to have multiple workflows to edit in, but we'll just stick with the one for now. If you multitask like me, you might like to have the big boy sequence where the the final video is being worked on, and then you'll have one or two extra sequences that you can use if you need to drag a video file in and hunt for a specific clip to use in your main video. But anyway, like I said, this will create a thing called a sequence. Notice how it has a little icon in the lower right corner that looks like a bunch of blocks stacked on top of each other. If you delete this sequence file, you delete everything. So just, yeah, obviously don't do that. But if you're incredibly stupid and manage to delete it, you can undo with Control Z and double click the sequence to open up the workflow again. The sequence stuff is getting boring, but chill the fuck out, we're almost done. Jesus. Make sure to double-click the file name of your sequence and rename it, so you'll know that it's your sequence. If you use a preset, it'll be called, like, Sequence 01 or something. But if you drag a clip onto the timeline to make the sequence, it'll just use the same name as the video clip, which can get confusing. So just call it Big Chungus or whatever you think is epic and hilarious, as long as you don't confuse the sequence file with a normal video file. Also, careful with double-clicking. If you double-click a video file to rename it, it'll open up in this thing called the Source window, which is really dumb and you'll never use it. Like, I'm sure it has a purpose, but I'm not going to explain it because it's stupid. So if you double click too quickly, it'll open the video file in the source window and you'll right click it to close the panel. If you need to rename a file, just double click slowly and then click out of the window. If you hit enter, it'll select a random file in the project folder for some reason, but it'll still save the new file name. There are a few weird little quirks like this in Premiere, but you get used to them. They're nothing deal breaking or anything. So once you drag your clip onto the timeline and make the sequence, you'll have two channel areas, video on top and audio on bottom. You have three of each by default, so you can get more by either dragging a fourth clip onto the timeline, which will add a new video and audio track automatically, or by right-clicking in the label area and adding new tracks. You have these tool shortcuts on the sides, which you'll use regularly, but you'll really only need two or three of them. You'll use the Razor, aka Cut, with the C key, to divide up the video into smaller clips. If you want to change to a new video clip here, just cut it where you'd like, and then you switch to the normal selection tool with V, and press the Delete key to remove the unwanted portion of the video. Pressing Shift while using the Razor tool will cut everything in that vertical section. I actually made Q a delete shortcut because it's easier to reach and I don't always want to right click and choose clear or move my hand all the way over to the delete key. But if you want, you can use the playhead here, aka the thing that moves when you play the video with the spacebar, as a reference point for where you'd like to cut. So if you're playing a video and you stop and say, hey, I want to cut here, make sure this little magnet icon is blue and activated. You can use the S key for that. Click on it and you'll see that your cut tool cursor will just snap to the playhead, so you don't have to tediously line up the perfect millimeter with your cursor, it just makes it easy. As briefly mentioned before, V is the standard arrow key that you use for selecting stuff. V is just your normal tool that kind of does all the basic stuff. The A key lets you use track select forward or backward, which is basically just like select all, but in a certain direction. Ripple edit basically lets you trim something while also closing the gap simultaneously. But you can also just right click on an empty space and choose ripple delete, which will close out the empty space. Make sure you're not deleting anything accidentally when you use Ripple Delete, since sometimes it can overwrite things on the top and bottom of the timeline as it moves everything around it. Rolling Edit lets you move the beginning and end of two adjacent clips, instead of having to do them both individually. You'll never use it, don't worry. If any of this is confusing, don't worry, you're not going to use most of these tools, I'm just explaining it to be thorough. Rate Stretch is a super useful tool because it lets you speed up or slow down a clip depending on how much space you need to fill. If I need footage to play for a little bit longer, like say I'm trying to show a cutscene and there's a few frames of a scene immediately after that I don't want to show, you can just rate stretch it a little bit and no one will be any wiser. I find adjusting a file speed to 90% and above is very difficult to notice, so it's good for closing gaps. To give a relevant example, if you were working for a TV station and they said they wanted a 30-second ad, trust me when I say they want that bitch to be exactly 30 seconds and 0 milliseconds. So that's a situation where you want to cheat a little bit and make certain sections shorter or longer without anyone noticing using the rate stretch tool. Also, if you don't like any of the default shortcut key bindings, you can go into the edit menu up top and choose keyboard shortcuts, and you can tweak anything to your liking. So, with all that out of the way, let's talk about the rest of the boxes around here. The project box, to review, is where all of your media will go. I prefer to view it in icon mode, but if you're more about labeling stuff in list mode, you can do that too. There's also a freeform mode that's kind of new and it confuses me. It seems to be about like visually arranging everything. Like if you're the kind of person that just sorts shit into piles, maybe it's for you. So use that if you want, I guess. The preview window up here is where you'll watch video playback, which obviously only happens if you have a video to preview in the timeline. Premiere is rendering the video previews in real time as you preview the video, so it might have some issues. The colored bar above the video in the timeline will tell you the render status of the video. If the bar is red, it's not rendered at all, and it'll probably run like shit when you preview it, which will happen mainly if you use After Effects dynamic link compositions, which my beautiful editor will touch on later, so don't worry, we don't have to get ahead of ourselves. If it's yellow, it's rendering in real time just before it gets played, kind of like laying down a brick road as a car is trying to drive on it. That's the best analogy I can come up with. If it's green, it's fully rendered, you won't experience any hiccups, and the video will play at full resolution. If it's running like shit for you, you can click this little drop-down menu next to the wrench icon underneath the video preview window, and you can change the video quality to be 25% or 50%. You can see when I try to preview a video in 25% quality, it's going to look noticeably bad in motion, but when I pause it, it looks really clear. That's what render means, to cause to be or become. You don't need to understand it 100%, but the short caveman version is program need generate video file, file need load first, if file load good, video look good and also run good. If it's running like shit, turn down the quality. You could also render all of the video footage in advance if you want to be able to fast forward through it quickly if you have a crappier processor. You render video by going up to the sequence drop-down menu and choosing render effects in to out. Rendering effects will render the video as well as any other special effects you put on them. Render in to out basically just uses in and out points to render only a specific selection. In and out points are just specifying to Premiere, here's the beginning and end of the part of the video I'm interested in. So like if you're scrubbing through an hour-long video and you find a 5-second clip that you want to export into a video and upload it to Twitter or YouTube or whatever, you can just set the in and out points with the I and O keys respectively, and Premiere will know that you're only interested in this small section. Anything referencing in and out points is referring to this. If you're confused, it's like when you click and drag to highlight some text that you want to copy and paste, but with video. If you set an in and out point and you want to delete them, you can just right-click the top part of the sequence and choose the option Clear In and Out. But anyway, clicking pretty much any of these render options will work. If there's some funky stuff going on with your video footage, like a visual glitch or artifact, you can try to delete render files and render them again, which is also in the same drop-down menu up above. Again, when it's rendered, it's green. If it's yellow, that's fine too. You can also press the M key to leave a marker, which your cursor will similarly stick to if the snap tool is enabled, again with the S key. If you want to take notes for when you should cut footage or change music or whatever, you can right-click the individual marker to edit it, assign it a color, leave notes, set the duration, kind of like a DVD chapter or a header or something, and so on. It's a good organizational tool if you're into that sort of thing. Alright, here's where the fun shit happens. The effect controls box up here is completely empty by default, but as soon as you click on your footage in the timeline, it'll show a bunch of information. Position is the X and Y coordinates of the video clip, aka left and right versus up and down. You can type the numbers into these boxes if you're a huge control freak, but I usually just drag it left and right to change the values, which are reflected in the preview window in real time. You can also double-click the video in the preview window, and then that'll let you move it around and make it smaller, etc. Scale refers to the size, and if you make the number bigger, it'll zoom in, while smaller numbers obviously make it zoom out. If you want to stretch the video footage, you can uncheck this box that says Uniform Scale, and then change the parameters for both the video height and width. Rotation makes the footage rotate. Anchor point sets the center of the picture in terms of like where effects will work. So for example, if you rotate the video with the anchor point in the middle, it'll spin like you expect it to. But if you set the anchor point on a corner, it'll dangle on that corner point. Opacity also makes the video more transparent. Like if you want to have a video behind another video and have one of them showing kinda. You understand what opacity is. Everyone knows what fucking opacity is. If you click on the audio channel, it'll let you adjust the audio settings, namely the level, aka the volume, and the panner, aka whether the sound will be louder in the right or left speaker. The part where things get really fun is the keyframing, which is a more technical term for animation. If you click this little stopwatch-looking icon, or this little gray diamond to the right of it, it'll add what's known as a keyframe. The most common usage of keyframes for me is when I want to have something slide on or off-screen. You set a keyframe for the beginning of the animation, which in this case will be off-screen, and then you move it forward however many frames until you want it to be on-screen, and then you adjust the parameters until it's visible, which will automatically place the final keyframe. Or you can just set a keyframe when you want the animation to start and end, and then just adjust both of those keyframes. The result is that the image will slide on screen and then stop abruptly. You can make this look much smoother by right-clicking on a keyframe and selecting the options at the bottom, either Ease In or Ease Out. Ease Out is when the animation is starting, and it'll smoothly accelerate as it begins to move. And Ease In is when the animation is ending, and it'll slowly decelerate before stopping. I abuse the fuck out of this interpolation because something smoothly sliding into place is much less janky looking compared to something just abruptly starting and stopping. Oh, also, if you want to full screen any of the panels in Premiere, you can hit the tilde key, aka the key to the left of the one key and underneath the escape key. It's good for examining small details, especially in the video preview window, but you can also use it to look at your timeline workspace if you need to have a lot of space to work with, and adjust all of the video and audio files for a particularly complicated edit. The effects panel is where you'll find all of your fancy schmancy transitions and special effects. Gaussian blur, dip to black, that sort of thing. Some of my favorites include vertical and horizontal flip, which do exactly what they sound like. Gaussian blur, which you can use to blur the background while placing something into the foreground. Also, make sure to uncheck the repeat edge pixels box if you don't like this shadowy vignette sort of thing. Cross dissolve, which blends two video clips together while you transition into the next scene. Brightness and contrast, which lets you make something lighter, darker, increase the contrast, etc. Drop shadow, which gives the illusion of a video clip or image having a shadow behind it. Crop, which lets you remove a specific section of a video and superimpose it onto another video, and feather it so it looks softer against the background, and many more. To use them, you simply drag them into the timeline and onto the video or audio clip, and you're good to go. Audio transitions exist as well, but I pretty much exclusively use constant power, which turns down the first track while increasing the next track, in a way that makes it sound seamless. You can search up these effects by typing it in the search bar, but if you're like me and you have a handful that you use constantly and exclusively, you can right-click in the empty space and click New Custom Bin, which will create a folder where you can drag and drop any frequently used effects for quick and easy access. Speaking of bins, Control-B opens up a new bin, which is Premiere talk for folder. This will likely be your most powerful tool as an editor, if you're anything like me and you like to organize the living fuck out of everything as much as possible. You can double-click while pressing the Control key to open the bin in your current tab, but I always double-click with Alt to pop up a new window, which you can then add to whatever panel you like. So for example, I'll have bins for cutscenes, specific gameplay moments, a folder just for images, a folder just for music, that sort of thing. If you make a clip you want to use for later, just cut at the start and end of the clip before dragging it up to your bin and labeling it. If you don't want there to be any audio from the clip playing, you can right-click on the video itself, go to Modify, and then where it says Audio Channels, you can just type a zero in there. Now when you drag it into the timeline, it will just be one video track instead of a video and audio track. You can type one in there if you want to change it back to normal, as it still contains the reference data for the entire video file from whence it came. Clips are also neat in the sense that if you want to elongate the clip length or shorten it, you can drag either side of the video until you get the shot you want, since it still remembers the rest of the video, and clipping a specific section won't suddenly destroy all the other information outside of that clip. If you have any issues with your video being glitchy or not rendering properly, you'll want to click on the sequence file and choose Sequence Settings, where you can tweak the settings, because most of the time, if my video is acting fucked up, then the solution is somewhere in here. Look up a video about what all the sequence settings mean, because I want to move on and talk about the fun stuff now, but yeah, don't forget about sequence settings if you have issues. I've contacted like 10 Adobe customer support people and they're like, have you tried to delete the media cache? And it always ends up being an issue with the sequence settings. So yeah, that's important to check. Also, it's worth mentioning that you can adjust the position and placement of literally any panel within Premiere. If you wanted to dedicate a monitor to just the video preview window, you can do that. If you're working with a lot of video files and want as much space as possible, you can use an entire window for just the project bin, especially if you're organizing and labeling stuff. The only downside is that you can't maximize the window exactly. You can only expand the window until it takes up most of your screen. You can also drag any panel in any direction you want, and depending on whether it's in the middle or the far edge, it will either separate it into its own panel or it'll stack with another. Also, if you see tabs that say like metadata and audio clip mixer and media browser and stuff like that, you can feel free to close out of them, and if you need them, they'll be sitting and waiting for you in the window drop-down menu. But again, remember that a lot of this stuff is for people in corporate editing environments, so stuff like metadata is just like leaving notes within the video file for other people to reference, the sort of shit you're unlikely to use for just just a YouTube video. But anyway, the nice thing about Premiere is the ability to move, remove, resize, and detach any window you want until you get the exact user interface that works for you. I also have an ultra-wide monitor, which is okay for gaming, but it makes for really nice audio and video editing, so you have plenty of screen real estate with which to work on your project. And lastly, when you're done with your video, you can press Ctrl+M to initiate the export process, which is a fancy way of saying make it into a video file. You can click this box that says Match Sequence Settings up top if you set up the sequence properties to be exactly how you want it and don't want any of that to change. Otherwise, you can change the format, which I always set to HEVC H.265. You can go down to the Basic Video Settings tab and change the resolution if you want. If any of the text is grayed out, just uncheck the box to the right and it'll let you tweak with it. You can also set the frame rate to make sure it's a 60 FPS video if it's gaming related. And to be honest, even if the original footage only captured in 30 FPS, I still like to set it to 60 FPS so that any motion graphics look smooth when animated. You can check off some of these other options like render at maximum depth if you're rendering content at 32-bit color depth, or reduce slash eliminate artifacts and banding in your video, but at the cost of a much longer render time. Maximum render quality can reduce aliasing or jaggy edges on frames when you're exporting something at a different frame size, apparently, but it's also good for maximizing the quality of motion in rendered videos. Use previews is useful if you're rendering within Premiere. Remember when I talked about the render color bar thing above the footage, and how if it's green, then the previews are fully rendered? Yeah, that. If you render the entire timeline video once it's all done, Premiere can remember those video previews and use them to speed up the final render. But if everything looks good and you're ready to complete the video, you can go to the bottom and click the export button. Or if you're feeling technical, you can press the Q button and it'll export the video in Adobe Media Encoder. Media Encoder can do a few things, but I really only know of one. If you export in Premiere, it'll just give you a flat progress bar that will load with an approximate ETA until it's finished, and you just have to sit and stare at it until it's done. In Media Encoder, you can begin the export on the video and then go back into Premiere and begin editing a new sequence while it's rendering in Media Encoder in the background. Another nice bonus is that in the not-so-unlikely event that you experience an unknown render error, if you export your video in Media Encoder, you'll be able to have a visual of what's being rendered in real time, and if you pay attention to the preview window, you'll get a good idea of where the problematic file in the sequence is, which will help give you a clue of where to begin troubleshooting. Otherwise, rendering in Premiere is fine too. Once you're done exporting, you can upload it to YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, BitChute, you name it. To be honest, that's most of it. There's still more you can learn, but that's the gist of the program. The next step is to get good with After Effects, which is like Premiere but on steroids, and with a radically different UI. I'm sure it's not that hard, but it's a little more visually oriented, and all the buttons do different things. So maybe one day I'll get better with it and make a tutorial video. For now, I'll show you a few things you can do in After Effects, but given that it's quite complicated and mechanical, I trust my handsome German editor, Lucas, to show you instead.
So let's talk about After Effects. The most time you guys are gonna use After Effects is to make your keyframes look a little bit better. There is a lot of stuff you can actually do in After Effects, like a lot of really cool animation, a lot of motion graphics, but we're not here to make some ad for Adidas or some stuff, just make some cool looking YouTube videos. So let's say you have a simple keyframe animation in Premiere. For an example, when Chase says, "Oh, my handsome German editor Lucas, I have this little animation where my avatar is coming up." So this looks not bad, if I can say so myself, but it looks a little bit stiff. So Chase already told you that there is a way to ease in and ease out your keyframes in Premiere, but I don't trust that stuff. Premiere has a little problem where your animation will rubber bounce if you have too much animation in it. You can fix that, but it's something that can happen really fast, so I don't usually use that. So what you do when you want to work in After Effects, you mostly will already create a new projects file. It's pretty much the same as Premiere. And when you have your projects file, you don't really do anything here. You import from Premiere. So what you do is, in any video you want to edit, you right click on it, and then you have this little part here where it says replace with After Effects composition. After you click that, After Effects will automatically start. So now you got your animation here in After Effects, where it's pretty much, it's the same. It's exactly the same animation. If you go back to Premiere, you now see it's got a little bit purple, it's got a little bit pink, which pretty much just tells you this is an After Effects composition. So now back in After Effects, the first thing you probably want to do is add some motion blur to it. This will just make the picture look a little bit faster and it will not look stiff at all. How you do it is you just go to this little icon here and just click it. After Effects has since, I think, 2019, a version where when you click this little icon, it will automatically activate. If you use older versions, you also have to activate this part, because if you're not, there will be no motion blur. So after you added your motion blur, it looks really nice, but you now want to have the keyframes look a bit nicer. So you can pretty much do the same as in Premiere, you can ease in and ease out, which you can do over the keyframe assistant, and there you have it, easy ease, it's pretty much ease in and ease out. You can also press F9, which I'm not gonna do because F9 is the button where I start and stop recording. So after you pressed F9 or used it over the right click menu, the animation looks way smoother, it looks a little bit nicer. But this will always look the same, ease in and ease out is pretty much always the same. What you can do is go on this little graph editor here and you will have these little lines. And I know these look really complicated, but you can get behind it really fast. So first you have to click on the versions you want to edit. I recommend if you just a small animation, click on both. You can press shift to have both enabled and you will now see the graphs, how the animation will work. You can see they go up when the animation is the highest, then go back and go back to normal. You can now pretty much just play a little bit around with these. This is not too complicated. I just recommend just do a little animation, how Chase showed you to do, export it into After Effects, and then just play around with the graph editor and see what cool results you're gonna get. So of course, if you think, man, that's way too tedious, this is so much work, I don't have the time for this, I have to watch a lot of anime, you should get a program or a plugin called Motion 2. It's a paid plugin, but it's, I think, something that should actually be in After Effects. You get these little bars you can turn around and it pretty much does the same we are doing in the graph editor right now, but it has a way nicer UI. So if you're finished and you like your little animation, you can just click out of the graph editor by clicking the icon again and you're pretty much done with your little animation. And for the basics, that's pretty much it what you're gonna do in After Effects. I will show you one more trick, which is masking. So the way I masked will pretty much be gone in a few months, because After Effects just released a new version where you have an auto tracking plugin that will just automatically mask everything that moves. It's still in the beta, but it's really good and it will take a lot of work of a lot of people. But I think it's still important that you learn how to mask actually. For example, when you have things that are a little bit smaller or like don't move, so you can't really mask it with auto tracking. So the way you mask is you have to click on the window you want to mask and you go in your little timeline. It's exactly the same as in Premiere, you just have some new stuff. We have the rectangle tool, we have the pen tool. We now will use the rectangle tool, I will use the pen tool later. But what you pretty much do, you just draw a little rectangle and you will automatically see that everything else of the video you don't put in your rectangle will disappear. And that's pretty much how masking works. So now we're gonna use the pen tool for the masking. So what we're gonna mask here will now be this little monkey fella. So of course, just like the last time, the video you want to edit, which is now here the zoo video, you have to click on it. Because if you don't click on the video you want to mask, you will just create a shape. I will demonstrate it right here. As soon as we click something and just draw something, we now have a shape. This works, of course, if you want to do some animation stuff, like having some boxes fly in or have like something drawn, but that's not something we're gonna talk about. When we have our video selected and we choose the pen tool and now draw around the monkey, you will see everything behind the monkey disappeared. So of course, this mask will not move with the monkey. So what you have to do is pretty much open your file, which now has a new folder under it, which is called masked. You have mask 1, and then you go on your mask path, set the time, and you pretty much just go frame for frame and edit your little points you just drawn, so the mask looks nice. Little trick for that, most of these drawn masks look a bit clunky, they're a little bit hard, so I would recommend to do some mask feathering and just play around with mask feathering and mask expansion, so you have a good looking monkey here. This frame for frame animation will of course be pretty much useless in a few months because, how I said, the new version of the After Effects has this rotor brush tracking tool, which works really nice. I can't wait to experiment with this more, but how I said, I think it's important to also learn this little masking tricks because you have more control over it. And also for stuff that maybe doesn't move, and you just want to have like a block or like a still image in the video mask out to make something behind it disappear. And of course you can also use your shape. If you hold the mouse, you can use different shapes, and we can now make the little monkey into a streamer. And that's pretty much it. How I said, the UI, the layout looks a little bit different, but it's pretty much the same as in Premiere. The knowledge you get by using Premiere, you can use pretty easy on After Effects. The only difference is all the keybinds, the shortcuts are different, so I wouldn't rely on this. So I would prefer to work a little bit more with the mouse in this scenario. But that's what you mostly do with After Effects when you want to do some YouTube videos. Just making your keyframe look nice, putting some motion blur everywhere, and maybe masking some stuff. So that should actually be the end of the video, but of course Chase wanted me to do one more thing, like always, and okay, I dance for you like your little monkey. The thing that probably a lot of you want to know, because it's probably one of the biggest meme edits you can have, is the trigger wriggle expression. And this one is pretty easy to do, because After Effects has a built-in plugin just for that. You pretty much just go onto Windows, and you activate this little part here called Wiggler. Now you have this little window in the down right corner. Maybe it's somewhere else for you if you have a different layout, but it's pretty much just a window called Wiggler. So, and how you pretty much do it is you use your little object that you want to let freak out, and you go into the position part. Like you have your transform parts, then you set your in position and your out position. This is like the timeline where you want it to wiggle. You mark both, and then you go into your wiggler window. I mostly use Jack, but you can also use different parts. And as soon as you have both marked, you will see you have more option in this. And then you can just play around with the frequency and the magnitude and just apply it. And you now see, oh, there's a lot of keyframes here. And when you start, you see the thing just freaks out. So this is pretty much one of the biggest meme edits everybody knows. You can also get the Sapphire plugin, but it's also a paid plugin where you get a S shape, which is more used for like smooth things and you can control it more. But this is just basic if you want something to like shake really violently, and I can just recommend using it. And I hope that's everything Chase wanted me to know, because I'm now out. Back to Chase.
So yeah, that's pretty much it. Hopefully this was easy enough to understand. If you have any questions about stuff, feel free to leave comments, and I'll try to respond to them if I can be of any help. No promises, because I'm not your fucking mom, but I'll try to be as useful as possible within reason. So yeah, thanks for watching. Hope it helped. Bye.